right, bit of a lag here, but we are recording. This is the morning, and I have to get this on tape. If I get interrupted for a call for work, okay, that's fine. Got to get this out to you, because it's really quite amazing what happened. I did my second night. I did this. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. I am an apex yogin. Wow. So I want to report what happened, because it's very amazing. At first, there was tremendous resistance to even trying it. I said, I don't really need to do it. Oh, I don't feel like it. I don't think it's going to work so well. You did it yesterday, and it was just right for yesterday, but right now, you just don't feel like it. And it was just all these excuses that said, don't do it. And I was pretty much thinking like, well, it's not going to work. But anyway, I persevered. I kept trying to do it. And it didn't feel like it was going to work or really be beneficial at all. But I just kept doing it. I said, well, I have nothing else to do. I'm desperate. Might as well. So somehow, I was able to keep doing it. Extremely difficult to keep doing it. But as I was able to keep doing it, I had this just massive amount of dreamlike material come up, of distractions of all types. But I kept persevering and persevering, and then ultimately what happened was I began to get these so-called spiritual type of imagery. And I got this, like, this lake, this beautiful, like, whitish lake, calm lake, appeared before me. And I just kept saying, I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. And then I realized that the lake was appearing to there to reflect what I was. But I said, no, I'm an apex yogin. Wow. I'm an apex yogin. Wow. I'm not looking for any reflection of what I am. I'm not looking for a reflection. So, and then then that dissolved, and before me appeared this, my mind's eye appeared this beautiful blue expanse. And I said, I just noticed. I said, I am an apex yogin. Wow, I am an apex yogin. Wow, and I kept saying that. And I realized that what was happening was, imagery was trying to claim that it can accurately reflect what I am. This is a reflection of what you are. But, and of course, apex yogin means we accept the fact that we're formless. We don't have any definition. So how can we be reflected? So those were temptations to fall into delusion, is what they were. Reminds me of Buddha when he sat down under the Bodhi tree and said, okay, and I'm going to be enlightened now. And all these temptations came to him. It's the same experience. This is an archetypal experience we all can go through when we actually really decide to take the position of, I am an apex yogin, meaning I am a formless yogin. I am a formless yogin. I am the pure spaciousness in which everything appears, but myself, I have no appearance whatsoever. So then how can I be reflected? So that's tipped me off. I said, wait a minute. This is an attempt to delude me. So these spiritual imagery, the stuff that came up, and then after I rejected those, I kept practicing. Then the more crass stuff came up. Yeah. I said, I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. So this is apex yoga meditation. Is you take yourself as an apex yogin, you're a beyond any reflection, possible reflection. No image can say, have anything to say about what we are. Now, I would suppose when we finally get this, then all imagery is just equal. That we see the sameness to it because we're not judging. Well, which one reflects me better? Oh, I think this white lake has a nicer reflection of me than, you know, something else. We realize that nothing reflects us at all. And then we just realize everything's just equal ornamentation of spaciousness. There's some sort of sameness that occurs, some sort of realization that occurs. It hasn't occurred to me yet, but I can see why it would. You're no longer searching for yourself, for reflection of yourself. Now, the belief that we can imagine what we are is delusion. And the other stuff that came up was more like, this is what you are. In other words, we can imagine what we are. But how can we imagine what we are if we're formless? How could we have a formless image? We're the pure spaciousness in which all images arise, but we ourselves have no attributes at all. So we can't possibly be an image. So we can't imagine what we are at all. So in this practice, I noticed there's a combination of all this imagery. And then when I rejected the imagery and I kept practicing, then these reflective kind of imageries came up. Says, yeah, well, we're not an image, but we're just reflecting. We're a mirror that's reflecting you, your image. And I said, no. How can formlessness be either an image or be reflected? Neither one. It's raining a little bit here. It hasn't really rained that much, but some areas they say that it has rained a lot. It's kind of very different areas are getting different amounts. It's kind of that sort of thing. But they say it will come down pretty strongly. But it hasn't been as the storm has not been anywhere near as what they said it would be. A little bit hyped at this point. But we'll see. We'll see how it goes when the colder air starts hitting, coming in. But some places they say have already gotten like over 5 inches, so that's a lot. That's a lot overnight, 5 inches. Oh. So you can see why there was a lot of resistance to practicing this again. They say the Buddha would he meditate for 4 days and nights or something. I don't know exactly what the durations were, etc. But he said, okay, I'm just going to keep meditating until, you know, and until I'm enlightened or I die. I'm not going to stop. I am an apex yogin. That's the meditation. I am an apex yogin. Above imagery and imagination. I'm formless. I'm the formless yogin practicing meditation. I am an apex yogin. So you have to meditate from that standpoint, or meditation is not going to reveal what needs to be revealed, that it's all just our own desire to be greater than God, to try and say that we can imagine what we are. In other words, define what we are. God created us as no definition, perfect formlessness, no definition, perfect freedom. And when we say we can either imagine what we are or reflect what we are, can be reflected, we're trying to cast doubt upon our true identity. We absolutely are. So the meditation is just stating, I am an apex yogin. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. So I just kept doing that, kept doing it. It was... That was really difficult in terms of getting started. So I was discouraged. I kept feeling like, nothing will happen. You won't be successful. This time it won't work. You just, it's not the right time to do it. Excuse after excuse after excuse after excuse. But it is working. It is working. So these temptations come to you. As you stick with it, you will get these temptations appear in your mind and saying, here, you don't need to keep practicing because this is what you are. This is what you're looking for. This is what you're looking for. This is the imagery that you're looking for. This beautiful pearl-like lake, a sort of whitish pearl-like lake that was super calm, peaceful. But then I noticed like a few ripples on it. I said, oh, it's a lake. And it's designed to, it thinks it can reflect what I am. Here's a good reflection of what you are. This will reflect what you are. And I paid no attention to it. I said, no, I'm an apex yogin. Wow. I'm an apex yogin. Wow. This is very abstract to say I'm an apex yogin. Wow. My imagery is wow. My reflection is wow. What I am is wow. And there's no mental imagery associated with wow at all. Okay? There's no reflection associated with it. But at least you're saying something. So continuity fear is assuaged that way. So we want to assuage your continuity fear. And we accept it. It's acceptable. It works. Because it has a word, a concept, a definition, imagery, reflection. Wow. My reflection is just wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. And that stops everything right there immediately. So you're saying, I do know what I am. See, we can't say, I know what I am, and be familiar with formlessness, which is because of our continuity fear, bias against certainty, bias against formlessness. So we just say, yeah, I know what I am. I'm wow. I'm an apex yogin. Wow is what I look like, what I can be expressed as, defined as, etc. So that's just a very tenuous term, so that we can feel comfortable practicing. We won't be without any sort of definition at all. That is too frightening for us. That's why we're a yogin. Gurus are another story. They're beyond the yogin stage. But they went through the yogin stage, okay? And we're in no hurry to be a guru. You know, let us be yogins for right now. Let the gurus be the gurus. And I'm praying, you know, and expecting the gurus to help me out, because I'm in a disastrous situation as far as sustainability in this world. It's, you know, I just said, wow, why wait until things get utterly destitute? That's just, I don't understand that at all. But I don't have any interest in this world. I don't have any interest in sustaining myself here. Actually, if the gurus want me here to help the Dharma, then it's their job to sustain me. My full attention is on this meditation. Okay, I can't be thinking about how to make money. I've never been able to even to understand how to make money, how to sustain myself. I've never been aware of how to do it. So all my focus has been on this spiritual issue. How do we get liberated from delusion? So far I've been sustained, but going forward I don't have a clue. And there's simply no way I can get a clue. I really don't know. It's a mystery to me. Because I'm not interested in the world. There really isn't any world. It's just, I can't get motivated in the way that most people are motivated to survive. It's like, why would I want to, survive here? For what? It's an insane asylum. All I could do is trust, you know, the gurus that somehow they're going to accomplish something. But I don't have the foggiest notion of how to sustain my life and the structure of everything. I really don't. But my focus is on this meditation. And helping the Dharma spread. But in this world, if you, the only ones that are really willing to listen are those who are sick and tired of this world, really. Just say, this, I'm just so fed up with it. And then those are the ones that actually will listen. And then when they get fed up with listening, then those are the ones that actually practice. Actually practice. Now, so this sort of practice, it seems like a last resort practice, because it brings to light the deception. And then we're not sure what's going to happen when we do this, right? So that's the resistance. And I don't know what's going to happen. But, you know, what can I do? I don't really have anything else to do here. So I might as well keep on working at it. Just see what happens. It doesn't hurt. Doesn't hurt. So far, nothing. You know, I'm calm and nothing has changed as far as functionality or anything like that. I'm just noticing and saying, oh, okay, that's interesting. The different styles of temptation that arise. I am an apex yogin. Wow. So no matter what arises, I say that. Even if Jesus arises, I'll say it. Even if Anandamayi arises, I'll say it. Whatever arises, you just say, I am an apex yogin. Wow. Okay? Don't deviate from that at all. Don't get in any conversations. You only have one thing to say, and you're only saying it to yourself, so to speak. I am an apex yogin. Wow. That's what I am. That's my identity. I don't have any other identity. Very simple practice. But also, it has to be done right. Okay? So you don't get in dialogues, discussions. You don't doubt what you're saying. You just keep saying it. That's all. You can do that. Anyone can repeat, I am an apex yogin. Wow. And sometimes you'll forget. Say, I am what? I am what? And then just say, that's okay. I'll get it back. I am an apex yogin. And then it comes back. And you just keep doing that. So I would say, before you actually meditate, just start saying this in your life. I am an apex yogin. Wow. Even if you have to spend the whole year just saying that as you go about your day, at some point you will need to meditate. There's no doubt about that. If you want to be liberated from madness and all afflictions, you will have to meditate at some point, like I'm doing now. You will have to do that. You will have to bring it up and see really what's going on in an experiential way, and actually experience the mind and its play, and how we're trying to tempt ourselves and deceive ourselves. So it has to become experiential. So you might as well get prepared for that, just in case you get feeling desperate, as in 218, for instance. And you may very well feel desperate in 218, actually. And you don't want to turn to drugs. You have to rule out all this other stuff. All right. So you feel the desperation keenly, and you say, oh my gosh, I'm desperate, and I don't know where to turn. But if you've already prepared, I am an apex yogin, and you say this, and you say, I'm an apex yogin, I am an apex yogin, wow. Then you'll say, oh, I can turn to meditation. That's what I'll do. So you see, it's so important to work on your good habits. When we say, well, what about, you know, the religions that teach good habits? Well, that's very important. It's a very important part of it. Because what I see now is that because I have such good habits and such discipline, there's no thought of turning towards the world for help for my desperation. That's unthinkable. So that is super important. That's what helps me then turn to the meditation. Now, religions themselves, all the, you know, the virtues, the morality, you know, the regulations they have and the restrictions and all that, that's not the meditation itself. But of course, they also have monastic aspects. Those who are very advanced do get to the meditation. So I'm seeing how it works now. So if I had worldly habits, there's no question I would be turning to those for help at this point. And I wouldn't be meditating. That is for sure. Absolutely for sure. So now I see how helpful religions actually are, even though theologically they may be very, very messed up. Perhaps they shouldn't... Well, basically they know that people won't understand what they're talking about. So they just kind of pamper people with theological explanations of what they want to hear. But the real helpfulness of religions is the moral disciplines, the habits. That's what's really important. And then as you reach this sense of world weariness and desperation, you won't turn to sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Okay? You won't turn to that. Now, I actually listened to some music last night, and my Holy Spirit was saying, no, don't do it, don't do it. I was trying to escape through music. That's my weak spot. But I listened to a couple songs, and the Holy Spirit was really telling me, don't do this. That's a mistake. I listened to Dion, a couple songs of Dion. But then I said, no, that's not it. I've got to do the meditation. So I could see how the temptation works very clearly. So you really have to work on your habits. I mean, it's easy to turn to drugs, all types of drugs, isn't it? The world is just offering you unlimited drugs. And I'm coming off of the flu, and so I might have said, oh, gee, maybe if I took some Tylenol or some sort of thing, maybe I'll feel better. You know, I'm feeling lousy. No, I was feeling lousy because I was feeling desperate. Spiritual desperation. That's the issue. So I was able to see this is the issue. There's resistance to meditation. And I'm thinking, can I go this way? And I literally felt the temptations trying to, let me go on the internet. Maybe I can see something that interests me, you know, and get lost in imagery and I did a video, a couple of videos that were beautiful imagery, and maybe that wasn't the answer either, you know, because that kind of disturbed me when I was trying to practice. So now I see the value of living a very strict life and working on all your habits. Super valuable. It's indispensable, really. That's why those who don't have that, they get tempted by some reflection, like Narcissus. Okay, they think they see their reflection somewhere, and they say, "Oh my gosh, what a beautiful reflection! Look at this pearl lake that's giving me this gorgeous goddess-like reflection or something. Oh my gosh, that's what I am." And then they get carried away with their own greatness, thinking how great they are. It's the trap of Narcissus, thinking they see the reflection. And what they really want. And the reason why they do that is they say, well, I can lean on my habits. That'll make me feel good. The sex, the drugs, the rock and roll. And then you see these charismatic pseudo-gurus trumpeting, you know, how great they are. And yet, you peel away the curtain, and you see they're all into you know, fornication, just in all directions. You know, deviance, fornication, drugs, wild music, orgies, parties, dancing. I mean, just the whole thing. I mean, it's just assorted. You know, their lives are actually very sordid, but that's hid behind a curtain of religious greatness. And you find that out later, you know, and you're just like, well, because they didn't discipline their habits properly. So they didn't face their desperation like Buddha did and just kept meditating. That's why. So that's why it's so important for your to live a life of preparation. Now all the religions know that. Tibetan Buddhism knows that. You have to cultivate bodhicitta. You have to cultivate a truly virtuous life in terms of your habits. And I've certainly been doing that for a long time. I realized I had to do that. And so certain things, worldly stuff is out. You know, is really, really out. You get used to not looking at bodies at all. You don't look at bodies. You know. You don't touch any sort of drugs whatsoever. You know, and you just keep working on all that. So it's just ingrained. Because you have to reject all those enticements that come to you to say, hey, here, this is a reflection of what you are. This is what you are. This is an image of what you are. Or this can reflect what you are. That lures you away from your meditation. So those who are indulging in bad habits, they're not going to get to this meditation, and they're not going to be liberated. Not until they it's more than cleaning up your act. That's the first step. Then you have to live it, and so it becomes totally acceptable to you, and you can't think of it being otherwise. And like I said, I could feel the temptation trying to creep back into me, trying to prevent me from even starting the meditation. There's a huge resistance to even starting the second day, the second night. But I was able to battle through it, but it was very tough. I just felt like an idiot. I said, well, I'm an idiot doing this, you know. It's not going to work. I said, well, you know, let's just give it a try anyway. Let's see what happens. Let's see. I didn't think anything could come of it. I said, I already did the meditation. I already know what to expect. No. No, this was deeper. This was deeper the second night. I saw the temptations of this pure reflections. You know, oh, here's a way to reflect your purity. How do you reflect the formlessness? You can't. That's a real trap, isn't it? So this modern world, this modern secular humanistic world, is a super deviant world. Okay, it's another reason why I'm not interested in this world. It's a super deviant world. And in no way are they going to be able to get to what they really want, which is to recognize their formlessness. Not the direction they're going at all. They're going into a very hellish situation. You absolutely must discipline yourself to not be attracted by the world. So that you can stay with your meditation. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. No matter what arises, you just don't. I mean, you notice it, but it's just momentary. You notice if something's arising, I'm just, okay, I'm an apex yogin. This is not what I am. I'm an apex yogin. Wow. That's what I am. I am an apex yogin. I already know what I am. I'm an apex yogin. Wow. And there's no imagery associated with that. There's no imagery associated with it. In my mind, I don't have any concept of I'm what an apex yogin wow is. Okay. I just know that's what I am. So all this imagery, whatever arises, I said, doesn't matter. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I don't investigate the imagery or look at it carefully. I say, huh, this is, no. I mean, I just notice it momentarily. Even that the beautiful blue expanse and the pearl white lake, I just noticed it and said, what is this arising? Huh? Oh, trying to be spiritual. So, well, I'm an apex yogin. Wow. Like that. And then it dissolved. It dissolved. Now, I'm interested in what's going on. Because I know it's legitimate. It's very legitimate. So I'll just keep doing it. And let the cards fall where they may. Now, some have said that in the modern age, things have changed, and we can have our cake and eat it too. We can be debauched libertines and still be enlightened, no problem. Not true. It's exactly the same now as it was in Buddhist time, as it will always be. That is, that we're formless, and we cannot have any reflection or image of what we are. Not possible. Not possible. So we have no choice but to meditate and recognize this fact. It's not that we finally, in modern times, have found the image of what we are, or found the right way to reflect what we are through modern technology and glamour and all this stuff. No, that's absolutely not true. So the path is the same, the meditation is the same. What are people bellyaching about? There's nothing to bellyache about. It's very, very cut and dried. Same as it ever was. Now, it's true that when you get these attempts to believe that you're some image, that you could develop these severe addictions, and breaking those addictions can seem, you know, horrifying. That is very true. And it is horrifying breaking the addictions. But there's really nothing else to do. So you have to go back to good old-fashioned morality. And you have to humble yourself. People think they're so spiritually advanced, they don't need to pay attention to that old-fashioned morality, you know. Because they're so advanced that they can find a really great image, a beautiful image of what they are, a beautiful reflection. These are the arrogant ones, the deluded ones. The ones who are trying to be greater than God still, okay? And for them, it's just an anathema to humble themselves and have to go back to... Now, for me, I've been going to, you know, to Catholic Church for like about 10 years or more now. Their theology is, you know, completely insane. But the fact is, it's a structure where you're reminded that you need to mind your P's and Q's, your actions... How you treat other people. You're supposed to live a very clean life, and so I appreciate that. Very helpful, very helpful. So this, it's helping treat the trouble. So what's wrong with that? I don't need their theology. I know theology way better than the Catholic Church knows it, but I do need their morality. You see. So it's helping, it's medicine, it's helpful. So there's no shame in being getting the right sort of help. People are reserved there, you know, they're conservative morals, conservative. So hanging around very conservative people is extremely helpful. Extremely helpful. Very strict. They're, you know, Catholics are not as strict as they should be, actually. There's probably better places to hang around, but strictness in morals and really taking it to heart is very, very important. So when the temptations arise, you will not be even interested in them. You won't even, and you will actually get to the meditation instead of taking refuge in vices, right? Taking refuge in worldliness, because I guarantee you, when you start this meditation, maybe the first night you'll be able to do it. The second night, you're going to feel like, I got to take refuge in something. This is I'm worried. And if you have these vices, you'll take refuge in them, for sure. For sure. And then you won't succeed. But you might cobble together some, you know, guru act, right? And then, of course, those who don't really want to succeed either, you'll seem like a savior to them. They say, hey, you don't really need to be enlightened, you know. You can celebrate the world. There's lots of people who want to hear that message because they don't want to really discipline themselves, go through the difficulty of disciplining themselves. And I would say no religion is perfect as far as moral disciplines go. You have to actually enlist the aid of the Holy Spirit. In my case, the Anandamaya Ma helped me out a lot. A lot. Tremendously so, actually. She's the one that really went to work on all that and made helped me understand how important it is. She was super strict. You have to be. I mean, emphasize that. The life of a yogin or yogini has to be to progressively discipline yourself to not be attracted by the vices of the world and to stay away from them. So certainly these Dharma kings understand this principle. It's very important. It's all important, really. Without that, success will not come. I still can't claim success, but I'm experiencing, oh, wow. Okay, I'm having good experiences of all of this. Enough to, you know, have hindsight and see, aha, okay. But when you really realize, okay, I'm going to have to get rid of these habits, then you say, okay, you know, let's do it. It's a done deal. I'm going to do it, and then you're okay with it. You're cheerful about it, and you say, great. I've had enough of failure. You know, enough's enough. You set it aside. You go cold turkey. You set it aside, and it's history. You don't go back to it. You don't go back to your old habits, and you just keep every day. Reinforcing, blocking. Now, it's a very, not a glamorous life that I've led at all, doing this. So if you're after a glamorous life, the spiritual path is not for you. It's not very glamorous at all. It's just drudgery. I mean, you just keep blocking the bad habits, and get used to functioning without them. Not calling on them to bail you out from boredom, from desperation at all. Just trusting the Dharma kings, trusting in the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, bail me out. I'm having trouble here. And always turning to the Holy Spirit and its advice. The Tibetans are very good at this, especially as far as attraction to bodies. They have all these meditations that help you dissect, you know, what the body is and think of the body. They say, think of the body. The Tibetan meditation masters know all about this. They say, well, think of the body. When attractive bodies arise in your meditation, think of bodies. But before you meditate, practice this a lot to be repulsed in various ways, to be absolutely repulsed by bodies. They think of them as a rotting corpse, you know, and all. They have many, many, many practices to just feel revulsion towards all bodies. Very wise practice, actually. And Anandamayi has helped me with that. I've said what she said before. Just to imagine, you know, just something truly repulsive, just hideously repulsive, to just the thought of it in your mind causes you just to feel, you know, this sort of a spiritual revulsion. So you have to back off like screaming. Oh, this is horrible. I got to get away from this. I do that. I have to use that practice. It's very effective. Because body thoughts will try to creep back into you as you get more and more desperate. So you have to have a really strong way of blocking them. Very strong way. And when the time comes, you will adopt these stronger ways. The Tibetans are really something, some of the top ones, that the meditation masters, you know, they've been through it themselves, they've helped so many through it. They know what the difficulties are, and they've explained, you know, how to diffuse those. So we're getting great help here from the Tibetan apex array of supreme adepts in meditation and being liberated from delusion, with massive assist from Anandamayi Ma, the Vajrayogini, whatever they want to call her. she's the top, top of the toppermost. And she said, "Oh, you having problems? Okay, try this. You know, try this. I tried it. Yeah, it works. Oh my gosh, that's horrible." Truly repulsive. So you're able to imagine bodies as being truly hideous. That's something you turn around and flee from, just in utter horror, you know, just, oh God, stay away, this is hideous. So we won't be tempted into saying, abandoning our practice and saying, oh, here's a lovely form that this looks like I could be this. I could be this. Look what my imagination is presented to me. Some lovely form. I could be this. This could be a happy identity for me, or give me happiness, like that. Here comes the rain. It's starting to come down harder now. So, dreary day, no work. Maybe I should just go back and do more meditation. Yeah. I find it helpful to do it during the nighttime. Now, of course, I've said that the meditators in history, they meditated all day and night, but they were usually in caves or someplace that's really kind of the world, shut off from the world. So night and day, it's pretty much the same to them. But for us in our busy lives, we have to go out and work and earn money and support and cook and do, you know, do all sorts of stuff for people, constantly active. It's very difficult to do it sustain it during the day. So I do it when I lie down for bed at night. I just say, you know what? Maybe like I woke up at 4 a.m. this morning, I said, okay, I'm just gonna start practicing now. So I practiced till about 7:30 or so. The phone rang 7:30, interrupted me. I was upset about that, but and I dozed off a few times. But oftentimes I wake up at 3 or 4 in the morning, and that's when I start meditating. This has been my history. I say, "What the heck? You know, nothing else to do. There's nothing bothering you. No phones, no noise. Just quiet, dark, quiet. It's like a cave, and you just." Sit there, just lie there with eyes closed and just start meditating and pay attention. Don't try to make anything arise. The stuff that arose for me, I wasn't trying to make anything arise at all. I just kept focusing on I am an apex yogin. Wow. And then everything that wanted to interfere with this automatically is going to arise because it feels threatened. It says, hey, wait a minute. You know, this is your identity. This, you know, what about this? I say, I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. And whatever arises is going to arise. It'll be unique to you in various ways, I would assume. And again, don't expect something in particular to arise. That messes your meditation up. You're just going to, no matter what arises, you're just going to keep saying, I am an apex yogin, wow. That's it. And just keep saying it. For, you know, however long, until it's time to get up in the morning, you just keep saying it. And if nothing arises, fine. But just keep saying it. I don't expect anything to rise one way or the other. But I just want to reinforce what I am. I'm just trying to reinforce in my mind what I really, you know, really am. That's all. And then I'm finding the mind is okay. Yeah, I'm not driving in the mountains right now. I think God's trying to save me, because you know it's dangerous, and it's supposed to get really windy later on, and the trees are going to come down really bad. If it gets as windy as they say it will, I mean the mountains sick gusts 60 miles an hour, or such with the saturated soil and the heavy rain, 60 miles an hour, whew, you know, trees are going to be toppling like 10 pins, you know, really. Not a good day to be in the mountains. Good day maybe just to meditate. So the truth is, as I see it, as those who really, really work on their morality and their virtue and their habits, even though they may not be glamorous at all, not like for me, no position in the world, no glam, no spiritual position at all. But they're the ones that are going to succeed, ultimately, way before the others do. Who just kind of give lip service, say, ah, you know, I don't need to do that stuff. I don't need to worry about that. I want to live a glamorous life. I want people to think I'm very spiritual, etc., etc. They won't make it that way at all. You have to be very strict with yourself. Very, very strict. I'm very, very, very strict. And, you know, the vices are just unthinkable for me. At this point, unthinkable. Yeah, it's like that. If you have a vice of trying to get, you know, greed for money, you know, then you have to come up with a practice that'll give you this terrible aversion to it. And maybe I have an aversion to money because maybe in the past I had a lot of money. I know I did in the previous life to this, and maybe before that probably had a lot too. So it's just, I must have trained myself to just have a, you know, I'm going to have this absolute aversion to money. Like, you know, you touch it and it's just got, it electrocutes you or turns into, you know, poisonous snakes, you know, or whatever just gives you the creeps and scares the heck, it just creeps your nerves out. Imagine that. So you even come near money, you get this loathsome, you'll touch money and you get this loathsome sores, you know, just suddenly turns into this virulent pus that spreads all over you and turns you into this hideous leper or something. You know, whatever hideousness you can imagine, use that to cut off these really bad vices and just, wow, stay away from that. There's nothing stopping us from doing that. If we're willing to, we can imagine something that is just utterly repulsive to us and we're shocked by how hideous it is and we leap back away from it like it was the devil itself. And it certainly is. Any image of what we think we are is the devil itself for us. The devil of conceited arrogance, you know. That we can define what God created as no definition. As Bhagavan Ramaharshi said, go beyond Bhagavan. I'm not Bhagavan. The body's not, you know, the body's not Bhagavan. Bhagavan's not Bhagavan. Go past Bhagavan. Come on. There's no image of what we are. No reflection of what we are. But we're not going to be strict enough with ourselves unless we're really sick and tired of this dog and pony show here that we call a world, which is just a hideous snake pit of temptation is all it is. That's all it is. That's why the Christian painters would paint all these paintings of, you know, hideous suffering and misery and stuff. That was helpful to religiously helpful to people to help shock them away from the world so they could actually meditate and get free of image and reflection. It's brilliant. You know, we don't know what we're throwing away, really, in the modern secular world. Basically, we're trying to, you know, build a more attractive snake pit, you know. All the more hideous, actually. They say, well, it's a bigger snake pit. There's more hideous snakes in it. As if we're supposed to say, oh, really? Oh, great. You mean more is better? So more repulsive hideousness is like, that's better? That's more attractive? We're supposed to say, oh, yeah, oh, great. That sounds like greed, doesn't it? Greed. So greed may be one of the worst sins of all, actually. I always used to say, no, I don't want it. 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 Imagine, if you're greedy, imagine like a mountain of gold. And you could use any techniques you want, but a mountain of diamonds. And all those, you know, and then imagine the diamonds are just as you touch them and grab a hold of them, you know, they turn into this hideous pus that is like sticking to you and getting into your pores and turning you into the pus too, you know, and you start to melt in this hideous pus, and it's just, ah, and you just want to, you know, get away from that, And you just, you know, keep practicing in such ways. This is why, you know, religion, we thought they're cuckoo. They're not. They weren't cuckoo. So all these revulsion practices are very, very essential for those who have these severe vices, which what we've done nowadays is we decided, hey, that didn't work for us, meaning we didn't take it far enough. And so now we're trying to celebrate our vices. Let's celebrate them. Maybe that'll work. That's not going to work. Let's make them more beautiful. Let's dress up our vices. Make them more beautiful. This is why this modern culture is so repulsive. It is so repulsive. Which is a good thing. We could look just. It's easy to look at culture and just say, oh my God, it's so repulsive. I can't even bear the thought of it staying here. This place is truly hideous. They're celebrating pus. You know, they're celebrating vile maggots, you know. It's like you kiss the culture. This culture, you know, opens its mouth. Looks like a beautiful goddess. And you go to kiss her. It opens her mouth. And it's just a hideous, stink, slimy, blackish, gooey pus full of maggots. You know, and she wants you to drink that down as you kiss her. You know, and it's just, it's like that. And when you practice way, you feel like cleansed. Like, oh my God. I don't want anything to do with that. Wonderful. So look at the modern world that way. Is this goddess dressed up in pearls and diamonds and tiaras and beautiful gowns and just the most beautiful goddess. And then you just, and she's saying, come kiss me. And you come to kiss her and opens the beautiful lipstick and open the mouth. And it's just this maw of this hideous slime. Of every noxious hideousness possible. And she wants you to drink that forever. Continue to drink that forever. And just pouring that into you. Try that. And as far as a practice for this world. For this world in general. This kind of knocks the whole world out. Your interest in the world. Let the world be symbolized by this gorgeous goddess who acts so beautiful and graceful. And you just think, oh, she's so beautiful. She'll make me happy. I can be happy with her. And she's even saying, come. I can make you happy. I'll make you happy. I'm here to make you happy. But you must kiss me. And then she just vomits this stream of hideous vomit into you, you know, just like a fire hose into your throat, and it flows throughout your whole body as this fire hose of utter pestilence, smallpox, and your whole body erupts, you know, in this hideous cancers and whatever you want to, whatever freaks you out. Just think of that. And she just vomits that all into you. Okay. Practice like that if you want to. So really, we're seeing now that the practices of religion, especially in the past, were so intelligent, so wise, so wise. I'm seeing that. Now, I always felt they were wise. I didn't rule them out. I said, you know what? These people were no fools. There were no fools. A lot of saints in history. They weren't fools. They did something right. They really did something right. And the modern age, of course, writes it all off as mental disease. Except they're the ones who are mentally diseased. The modern progressive humanists are extremely mentally ill. They're trying to say, no, anyone who believes in God, and you can reach God realization, and we need to turn against the attractiveness of the world, and they said, oh, you're mentally diseased. You need to celebrate the body, celebrate the attraction of the world, celebrate your vices. Come on, let's realize we're all okay. We could all use drugs, sex, drugs, rock and roll for everybody, free love, free sex, free drugs, free rock and roll, and that'll make us all happy. We need to get rid of this, you know, they say we need to get rid of this repressive religion that's repressing our happiness. You know, if it feels good, do it. You know, but they're They want to repress you. They want to suppress and repress you. Let the inner goddess out and celebrate your sensuality, all that stuff. These people are extremely mentally ill, actually, and are really simply trying to market this hideous snake pit of vomiting pus into you. They want you to drink this loathsome pus forever. That's what they want for you and for themselves. So they don't have any compassion on themselves at all. They're trying to be very vicious to themselves. And you just have to tell them, look, no, I feel compassionate towards you, and I don't share your hatred for yourself. And I won't share your hatred for yourself, actually. Because I know what you really are, which is your formlessness itself. You can never be defined. Your pure freedom. You're unscripted, no storyline to you at all. So there's a very big parting of the ways between those who are going to, you know, get with compassion, real compassion, and those who want to keep hating themselves, thinking that's the answer. Because they are now, the ones who are severely mentally ill, are projecting this onto the ones who aren't so mentally ill, and insisting that they're the ones who are so mentally ill. And so it's this war, it's a war going on, and what they're saying is, no, you have to hate yourself as much as I hate myself. And we have the right to say, no, I don't have to hate myself. I don't have to hate myself. I can have compassion. The Dalai Lama says compassion is all important. Well, there's a ground of truth to that. I mean, he's using it as a way to an easy term, but if you really follow that compassion, it has to do with the spiritual path entirely, because that is having compassion on ourselves. So he's really saying the spiritual path is where it's at, and he's very strict. You know, he calls drugs, they're poison, he says. He's right. They're absolute spiritual poison for you. The vices are poison. Now, they should be more strict with some of their own, in my opinion. You know, the good thing about Christianity in the past has been willing to censor those Christians who mess up. They're called on the carpet. And they're denounced and saying, you have slid back into the ways of Satan and you must repent. You know, and you know, very strict about it, where it seems as though in Tibetan Buddhism, those who have gone wayward are kind of, it's like, well, we don't want, you know, they're part of the club, we don't want to, you know, make us look bad by criticizing them too much. And to me, they go too soft on them. They should be called out. They should be called out. And Christians don't hesitate to call one another out, as they should. We're trained that way. So they may think, well, who are you to call us out? Well, what do you mean? I mean, that's totally dharmic to call out those who have gone wayward. And you don't handle them with kid gloves, you know? And Roman Catholicism should have been stricter with their priests, right? So it's obviously it's a touchy subject, but they should have said, hey, you know, you have fallen into the trap of Satan, and you need to do some more work. But the problem is when you lose those techniques that work, those revulsion techniques, for instance, for your vices, you don't really have the tools to help out. So you kind of feel impotent. It's like, I can't really sense them because I'm trying to be compassionate with them. I don't want to criticize them. No, well, compassion is give them the tools to help them so they can be helped. So some of these philandering Buddhists should be told by other Buddhists and by other dharmic-minded people around the world, hey, you have fallen back into vices. You're not representing the Dharma well. And so you need to go back and do more training with these techniques and clear that up. Fix it. Repent. Say, look, I've fallen into some... I fell back from my meditation because I was tempted by some beautiful imagery or whatever, and I need to go back and do these revulsion practices so I can clean this up. And if they don't want to do it, then they have to be put down as dharmically, you know, dharmically wayward or something, right? There has to be some place to, I mean, the Roman Catholics would remove the priests, some of them, they'd shuffle them around, but some of them are removed and put into retirement. They shouldn't have no more contact with the body of Christ. Well, those wayward Buddhists who don't want to repent should have no more contact with the Dharma, the Sangha. They shouldn't. They shouldn't. Why should they? But it's because we've gotten too tolerant and not using these practices that actually work that the whole thing is collapsing. Yeah, these philanderers say, "Oh, yeah, I know, but the women are so beautiful these days. You know, I don't want to feel repulsed towards them or something." I said, "That's not dharmic. What do you mean?" That's totally failing. Totally failing. That attitude should not have contact with the Sangha. In no way. They're encouraging failure. And it's true that the amount of accoutrement and the way women present themselves in the world today is, you know, just astonishing array, you know. But we know it's all, you know, rotting corpses is all there is to it. And open the mouth and all the vomit of hell is there, okay? So who are we fooling? You know, that's not dharmic. To fail to see through that is someone who has, you know, too many vices to be in any position of authority. That is for sure. Same thing with drugs, rock and roll. It's a constellation of vices, worldly vices, right? One of the best ways to lose interest in the world is to be married, actually. And it's super important to be faithfully married. Super important. Because that'll get you to lose all interest in people and bodies, won't it? Absolutely it will. That's why divorce should not be allowed. The real spiritual purpose of marriage is to become completely disenchanted with the, you know, opposite gender or whatever you're married to, become utterly disenchanted, and you really don't want to have anything more to do. Like if you're a man, you say, "I don't ever want to see another woman again in my life." That's the real purpose of marriage, and that's super helpful spiritually, super helpful. So if divorce is easy and allowed, you get to a point when you're so disenchanted. Where's the romance? You know the fire. There's nothing cold as ashes after the fire is gone. That's the point when it starts becoming helpful to you. So of course you have to stick it out. So the kudos to the Catholic Church, and they promote sticking out marriage. It's very important to stick out marriage. Of course it is. Because that's the part that's spiritually helpful. So we have these lunatics, secular humanistic lunatics, trying to tell us what our spirituality needs to be about. And they're like absolute devils, you know, lunatic devils who are teaching us the opposite of what is helpful, the very opposite. No, it's great to be married. You become so unhappy. And you realize the world just absolutely is a terrible place. It's horrible. That's great. You should be thankful if you find a spouse like that. Absolutely great. And as they rot and get old and hideous and everything's terrible, you sit there and say, "Oh my God, it's horrible." Then you realize, yeah, it's all terrible. And it's like one of the most beneficial things there are. So the family morality, no divorce, all this stuff. No infidelity, okay. Infidelity is absolutely not no infidelity whatsoever. Because when your marriage starts becoming just, it's that song by Loretta Lynn and Conway Twitty, "Love is where you find it when you can't find it at home, and there's nothing cold as ashes after the fire is gone." You know, terrible song. It's promoting infidelity. The culture has been promoting infidelity, like the music, like crazy, right? So they're saying, hey, when your marriage reaches the blahs, as it always does, and you can't even stand looking at your spouse, they say the thing to do is, cheat on the side with something new and fresh and some lovely goddess or god, and your life will be all fired up again, everything. You know, that's super Antichrist teaching. Super Antichrist teaching. Now, infidelity has to be absolutely unthinkable in society. Absolutely unthinkable. And it used to be. If you committed adultery, you were branded. You had to wear a letter A around. You were scorned by society. That's absolutely the way a spiritual society cannot have it both ways. And so we have to decide, what kind of world do we want? And we have all these maniacs running culture and society right now. They want a hellish realm. Well, they'll get it. But I won't be part of it. And hopefully a lot of us will realize that we don't want any part of that. And in the past, women had to be very restrained. They couldn't go after other men. Of course, keep in mind that a lot of infidelity, a married man cheating, it's a woman going after him because her marriage is bad. And then she says, I see that guy, and I'm going to go get him. I'm going to go after him and get him. Okay. In the past, that the women were much more restrained, and they said that is absolute sin. So the church saying, you're going to burn in hell if you commit these sins. Well, that is true, because you're going to remain in hell, and you're going to continue stoking these fires of delusion, which is going to cause you to burn with this inner frustration. Okay, that is very true. So they were scared. They said, if you do this, you're going to burn in hell forever. And so they restrained themselves, and they absolutely, you did not go after a married man, and vice versa. A man doesn't go after a married woman. Absolutely not. And the punishment in the old days was severe for that. And so it made it much easier for society to become a spiritual society. Much easier. You know, you got married, and arranged marriages are the best. You get married, that's it for your life. You don't even remarry. And life becomes blah, and you turn to God for the answers to the blahs. And God starts giving you spiritual practices. You become aware there's a way to get liberated from this madness, and you work at it and you practice it. This is how it actually works. So again, the people in charge of this world now are worse than lunatics. I mean, the worst of the worst. They're leading us down the primrose path into this belching pus pit of hideous torment, actually. When you believe that you're an image, you suffer hideous torment. And the more you believe that, the more hideous torment you feel. And then you feel you become like a lustful maniac at some point, where you think you just have to grab anybody there is, debauch yourself with everyone. Okay, and the fires, and with whiskey and drugs, and you feel you just have to debauch yourself continuously. You get caught up in that, and then you just hit bottom. This is what happens. This is where this world is being led right now. And anyone who tries to institute a reformed morality and civility in society is set upon with pitchforks and fire. They want to burn them at the stake, right? If anyone even dares open their mouth about it in any position of leadership in the world, these maniacs want them burned at the stake. They're heretics. So it's pretty hard to be compassionate in the world at this time. Nobody will even talk about it anymore. It's amazing. I never hear anyone even talk about it anymore. We've been, they've been trying to shame shame spiritual wisdom out of existence. But really, they're just becoming more and more mentally ill, is what the problem actually is. They're caught up in vicious circles. Vicious circles dragging them down deeper and deeper and deeper. And then they end up, you know, debauching themselves into the grave. And everybody has these funerals where they celebrate their debauchery, where they say, wow, he or she was like, led a really great debauch life. They're free, open lifestyle, really debauch life, and let's celebrate, you know, their debauchery by everybody getting drunk and having an orgy or something. They'll, you know, I mean, they celebrate their, you know, when they die, like what a great person they were for you know, turning their back on religion and you know, living a life of debauchery, and that's something we really want to emulate. That's really what it's come to. That's really what it's come to. It's creeping in, it's crept into everyone's lives now, where everyone feels ashamed to speak up. Isn't that insane? It is insane. It is insane. The inmates are running this asylum right now. You don't want that. It's certainly an insane asylum, but you want the therapist running the insane asylum, not the inmates. Because that just makes it worse. You don't get better. You don't get better when that's the case. It doesn't happen. You get worse. So really, the way to do it is to start using these skillful techniques. And aversion training is actually very, very helpful. Very helpful. And of course, this is abhorrent to the maniacs. Because they're trying to celebrate their vices. So they don't want to even know there's a way to avert these vices. But aversion training is very, very helpful. But the therapist these days, oh no, let's just talk about it, you know, and let's just have some compassion. So yeah, it's good, it's okay, you know, it's fine, and all this stuff. No, it's not. No, it's not. We should start dreaming up aversion, not dreaming up, but being aware of aversion training for it. Like the very thought of seeing a movie, you should feel like someone's pouring molten lead into your brain or something. Or someone is like, you know, torturing you in some way that you just dread. That, you know, instead of a movie, you see someone say, oh, you're going to watch a movie. Okay, here you go. Before you watch this movie, you know, we're going to stick these needles up underneath your fingernails, and you know, whatever just freaks you out, you should start imagining that, and you say, God, I don't want to watch a movie, no, like that. But most people can't do that. What I did was I just watched movies all day, every day, for a year or so, until finally I just said, I'm sick of movies. I'm so sick of movies. There's that other way of just overindulgence. You say, like, you want a drink? Okay, great. Here's the bourbon or the scotch, and you're just going to keep drinking and keep drinking. I got like 10 bottles for you. You're not going to stop drinking. Every day you're just going to keep drinking and drinking and drinking. After a while you get so sick, you just say, I'm not going to drink again. But then it creeps back on you, so you kind of need a combination of the two kind of therapies. Losing interest is of course very, very important, very important. But there's different modalities, different ways to go about it. But you have to, the purpose has to be understood. But I think it's time to bring back aversion training, too. I really do. That's what we've been overlooking. Really overlooking that. It's such a taboo in society. It's such a taboo. They think those people who did that are you know, hideous, anti-human. Anti-human. Absolutely, they're anti-human. Of course, because we're not human. We're spirit. We're formless. And humans are just our images that we're using to try and convince us that we're really not spirit. Of course we're anti-human image. We must divorce ourselves from any human image whatsoever, actually. The only human images that are acceptable are the great, you know, the Dharma kings, because they're story-free. They're story-free, and they invite you to go beyond their image and experience the feeling that they're experiencing, the freedom that they're experiencing. They never identify with their bodies at all. That's why you see the statues of Buddha or Jesus, etc. Now, some religions like Islam say, let's just do away with body that altogether. And that's fine, too. That's fine, too. That's okay. That's okay as well. It's stricter, you might say. It doesn't want to err into bunch of statues from lesser beings, you know, lesser than Dharma kings. It's understandable. It's sort of like, okay, let's, abundance of caution here, abundance of caution. So the modern world is, it's not modern. It's hell. To say, it's not the modern world, it's the hellish world. This is becoming very apparent. They're trying to say, well, we can build a better hell. It's kind of a weird way of looking at it, to build a better hell. What does that mean? That the hell is more attractive? So that you're more attracted to the vomit when the goddess opens her mouth? I mean, is that a better hell, or is that worse? It's better not to be attracted in the first place, right? They say, oh, no, we made her even more attractive. Yeah, but it's the same vomit. So I don't think you want to make vomit more, you know, dress it up more attractively. I think you want to just expose it for, you know, what it is. Say, my gosh, this is horrible. Now, in the meditation, I guess ultimately they say that you see pure spaciousness instead of images, and then all images now appear as if sort of some diaphanous ornamentation of pure spaciousness. So you shift from looking at images primarily you're seeing spaciousness, pure spaciousness, as the inherent quality of everything. Everything is abiding in pure spaciousness. Equally. So that there's a shift there in how you experience your perceptual shift. That's what will take place ultimately. I've had that happen several times. It's like absolutely gentle. It's just one moment you're more focused on images, and the next moment you're more focused on pure intrinsic spaciousness. And you say, oh, that's it. Okay. It's just that gentle. It's just one moment it's this, the next moment it's this. There's no kundalini rising or anything like that. It's the moment seems just the same as the previous moment, except now it feels different. You feel like, oh, this is it. Oh, this is it. And it's calm. And you say, this is the way it's supposed to be. This is what's familiar. This is what's really... This is what I am. This is how it is. This is how it is. Oh, okay. Wonderful. Wonderful. Everything is that way. And your interest in trying to be an image has been released, and everything has been released with it. And yet, the appearance is still there, but they're seen in a different light. as in no way are they somehow separate from intrinsic spaciousness, from the ground of being. In fact, they're completely saturated with it. Everything is. And there's no fixation at all. So they're not really images. It's just a play of ornamentation. And you cease valuing imagery and images and reflections. Cease valuing the screen that's supposed to be reflecting an image too. The screen is also just ornamentation. Ornamentation. So it's neither, when you watch a movie, it's neither the images that are reflecting off of the screen, nor is it the screen. Neither one. Formlessness cannot be reflected at all. So what good is a screen? A screen can't show you what you are. Nothing can show us what we are. We're everything. We're all in all. And nothing in particular. And thus we're free to always flow with experiencing, have experience, be the flow of experiencing, without ever feeling that we're ever deprived in any way, threatened with any kind of deprivation in any way. No calls for work. Yeah, wow. I've reached Armageddon point here, so something has to happen. Well, it is. I mean, at least I'm speaking up here and saying the right what needs to be said, as I always have tried to. It's just another day. None of this is surprising at all. This is what we've always been told. I'm just reaffirming what we've been told is true. And our perspective has been skewed by materiality. By suddenly we have all these interesting new forms. We even have artificial grass that looks real. And gleaming new cars are coming out all the time, so gleaming, and we've gotten beguiled by all this materiality, and so we've just, in order to pursue this, we've had to turn our backs on wisdom and denigrate it in order to justify our pursuit of materiality. But at some point you have to realize, wow, okay, another luxury car, you know, comes out. I was looking at one yesterday, the Genesis Open on golf tournament. I said, what's the Genesis? And I said, it's a luxury car by Hyundai. So I was looking at the website, and they showed all this stuff. And I said, well, the car that we just, our car got totaled. And so it's a little complicated, but it's not my car. See, it's a family car. But we had to lease another one. Another one had to be leased. And it's a modern car, and so it has all these safety features and all these bells and whistles and stuff. It's like, okay, you know, a couple of days you're used to it. What's the big deal? You know, what's the thrill? Well, this Genesis has all the same stuff, and ours has, you know, fake wood. Maybe they have real wood, fake wood lining here, and it's all very, very, you know, glitzy, and things look so smooth and sleek, but you pay like 2 or 3 times more for the Genesis. But it's the same package. The safety package is the same. They have adjustable rear seats, or memory for the rear seats. You know, we have memory for the front seats. They have memory for the rear seats. Oh, okay, big deal. You know, you know, console in the back was, you know, or something. Oh, okay, they have a console where you can dial in your I don't know, a few little bells and more bells and whistles, and they charge you, you know, an arm and a leg more for it. But maybe they have like a V8 or V6, so it's a little more powerful, but we have like a turbo, which is like a rocket. Yeah, but it's the same. And you can upgrade, and you can make, you know, just a few more little bells and whistles, and you think, oh, you know, I've made it or something. But you get used to that stuff in a day or two, and for me, it's like I'm not even attracted to the car anymore. It's just like been a couple of weeks. It's like whatever. The one before I liked even better. It's a little more agile, you know, and I'd rather just have a car from the '60s actually, with no bells and whistles. Because then I have to worry about anything. I'd rather have something with no computer in the car. And if something breaks, I could fix it. Get out there, get the wrenches out, get in and fix it. Take spare parts with you on a trip, which we used to do, and if something breaks, we just fix it. I'd like the option to buy a car that has no computer, no electronics in it. You don't have that option anymore. In fact, the amount of options you don't have are astonishing. Probably more, we can recount more things that we don't have options for than we do. I mean, you literally have to have electronics now running your life, basically, right? And I know people who refuse to buy cars with electronics. They buy old used cars and fix them up. They turn them into mechanics so they can keep these old cars running. Because they say, I won't have electronics in my car. I hate it. So many people hate it because there's no option anymore. So I don't find these cars very interesting at all. I find it super controlling. Anything you want to do, you have to take in the dealer, pay an arm and a leg. You can't do it yourself. So you become very much like enslaved by this electronic world that we're in. Very much enslaved. I mean, what if you want to go on some trip out in the middle of, you know, the Amazon or something? I mean, do you want to take one of these cars with you? Are you kidding? The slightest little thing, and you have to have a computer code or you can't fix it. You can't make it go. That's ridiculous. It's very dangerous, actually. You're going to go across the Sahara? You're going to have some adventure? You can't take these cars. You're going to have to build the car yourself with no electronics in it. So if something breaks, you can fix it there, then and there. So things are becoming so, so technical. Everything is coded with so much technicality and code that you have to have these technicians with all this equipment and stuff to do anything anymore. And who wants that? That's horrible. That's horrible. Truly, the culture is becoming beyond horrible, which is great. So we should find it repulsive enough to meditate, right? So really, it's almost like it's custom made for liberation right now, if we see it that way. For men, every man I talk to, they find women very vile now. They're just repulsive. They're so repulsive, which is great. Which is great. That's very helpful. So meditate then. Don't complain, meditate. That's helpful. You don't want these sweet, demure women, and you know, that seem so nice, because you know, then you waste time thinking I'll be happy with this one. Of course you won't. You'll get absolutely bored out of your mind with them. Which is great too. But right now it's like, they're like, wow, my God, this is, you know, hideous, hideous. So meditate. So yeah, the world's a terrible place. Great, meditate. So in other words, you get lemons, make lemonade out of it. Make lemonade out of it. But for me, the more they try to beautify the world, the more repulsive it is. That's the last thing you want. Now, beauty traditionally was presented by religion, but only in a certain context where you could get used to it and realize that's not it. And it is designed to point to something beyond it. So, I still do beautiful videos, I have, but it's in the context of saying, okay, this isn't it. It kind of helps run interference, saying, even if I got this, something so beautiful like this, that's still not it. And then I explain what really is it. Okay. So maybe I should do some narration on some of those videos. I did a couple yesterday that blew my mind, really. It really blew my mind. It was just the most amazing videos I've ever seen. And for anywhere. I mean, I did the one with Foam at the Beach. There's a second one. I haven't posted it yet. I don't know what to do with it because it's kind of dangerous. It's so beautiful. You put it on full screen and high def. And I just, like I say, I've never seen anything like this. But maybe I should do a vomit narration over it. Seriously. But in seeing it, though, at least I say, okay, I've experienced this, and it's not it. And then it really helps you go beyond. Say, okay, let me not think that this is it. So in that way, it's helpful if you don't get fixated on it. So that's why this beauty should be for those who are, you know, advanced, very advanced, and they take it in the right way, and they don't become fixated and enraptured by it and think you're some great artist. Oh, please give us more of this great stuff. And they realize, okay, this is helpful to see this beauty and absorb it and then realize, okay, but I'm still miserable, so I need to meditate. It's like that. It's helpful in that way. It's helpful in that way. So I kind of bring to light stuff that's pretty epically beautiful. And you realize even epically beautiful stuff isn't it. I almost got killed taping this stuff too. Really. Hidden dangers beneath the water. So beneath the beauty of the world is this concretized delusion that trying to make us believe that we're concrete, spirit is form. That's what it's really, really about, the world. So I don't know what I can do to make these videos epically helpful. But, you know, you have to understand, I don't know how to link them with the teaching so they're inextricably linked. I can't, YouTube doesn't allow you to edit anymore over 1 hour. That's really terrible what they did. I don't know why they did that. There doesn't seem to be any reason at all for it. They didn't explain it. They said it's a glitch. They haven't fixed it. So I can't edit it into one of these tapings, so I'll have to see what the Holy Spirit will advise me. And I don't know. Maybe don't even post it at all. Maybe post it. Do some narration. Do something with it. So it's difficult to say, because we've gotten so skewed, the whole culture is so skewed. You know, it was almost like we're all, everyone for themselves. We don't really know how to approach truth anymore on a consistent basis. No, on a cultural basis, certainly we don't have any cultural basis to approach it anymore. We most certainly don't. That's why Jesus said A Course in Miracles is a self-study. He understood the cultural basis for approaching truth has collapsed. So don't expect to find it in culture at all anymore. So I have to see what comes up. I don't know exactly what to do, but I was watching it last night. I was editing and I finished and I looked at it. Full screen, high def. And it kept stopping because my computer isn't fast enough to do high def. But, holy cow. It's like I've never seen anything like that before. Never seen anything remotely like that. It was just astonishing. But, there again, it's just like, you know, vomit. Imagine it's just all this beautiful vomit. It's right. But it caused me problems in trying to practice. I kept running through my mind, but I was able to get past it. So maybe it was helpful in some way, in an advanced way. But the best practice is to say, I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. That is simply stating your identity. Just simply state your identity. Don't worry about, the Dharma kings know what you're referring to, okay? So when you don't need to worry about trying to explain it to yourself or to anyone. I am an apex yogin. Wow. That's it. In other words, I am someone dedicated to the realization of formlessness, intrinsic spaciousness, formlessness, non-definition, right? I'm dedicated to that. So I am an apex yogin. I am an apex yogin. Wow! That's the only definition I'm allowing. That's just wow. That seals it right there. It just seals it. No discussion. I am an apex yogin. Wow. And if you can just practice that, then right away you're into the most advanced practice. But again, I'm seeing the difficulty of sticking with it based on, you know, if you have an attraction to vices, they almost certainly will snare you. They will try to snare you. And then you're going to become like a, you know, like, oh, should I? When you see something really beautiful and you realize even this doesn't do it for me, that's kind of scary. If you don't know how to meditate, you're going to be scared. That's a problem, you see. That's a problem. I don't know how to deal with that, actually. It's even this, isn't it? And you think, oh my gosh, maybe I need to combine all these vices. But if you have this, I am an apex yogin practice, then you just say, well, I can just practice. I am an apex yogin. This for sure is going to work. I feel for sure this will work for everyone if it's actually done. So, you know, I feel I don't know exactly how to proceed, but we'll have to come to light. In terms of any other videos, really. Don't want to try to glamorize the world and think, oh my gosh, there's so many things I can do to make the world look beautiful. You know, that's dangerous. I went through a phase of ocean beauty, and then the Holy Spirit said, that's it. That's enough of that now. Now I want you to meditate. So you have to realize it's a phase you go through just to realize this isn't it. And look at it that way. You know, this isn't it. As I stopped, the Holy Spirit blocked the surf sites. It blocked me going to the beach. It blocked everything to do with the ocean and all that. Because I was kind of getting into this mania of just, I can do so many things with the beautiful ocean, and et cetera, et cetera. But the Holy Spirit said, no, you've done enough. You've seen, you know, the best of the best. You've seen the slow motion, all this, the very top gorgeous stuff. He says, that's representative of what it is. And the work you did is even better than that. And so now it's time to shift over to meditate, to meditation. I stick it out, you know, tape in the rain. I've done a lot of videos on water. In a long time ago, and in the 90s, I threw all those away. And I could go out and do some gorgeous, you know, rain and all this kind of stuff. I've already done that. You know, water is very beautiful. I like taking video of water and how it can appear and all the stuff of water. But even water isn't it. Even water isn't it. And so you, even when the water appears in your meditation, just say, I am an apex yogin, wow. I am an apex yogin, wow. So maybe this will help your meditation, for if you're meditating, to see the most beautiful kind of depictions of water. So you're used to it, and then you say, you know what? I've seen it, but I'm still, you know, I've still got the blahs. So it's not it. But I don't feel I've been deprived. I've seen it, and I don't feel I'm really deprived. So I'll just stick with, I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. It's starting to rain pretty heavy now. So here comes the heavier stuff that they said was going to come in. And I could do, you know, my problem is I can do innumerable tapings of beautiful nature and stuff. I just can imagine all different ways to do it. But the Holy Spirit says, enough's enough. You've done enough. You know, at some point, it's time to meditate now. Start meditating. Don't be pursuing. I think that's why I got my bad knee, is the Holy Spirit was realizing you have to be blocked because you're getting so skillful at making movies, you're starting to figure out, you know, how to do all these beautiful effects and everything, and this is just going to waste your time. That, you know, you're ready to meditate now. So I got the bad knee, and that really stopped me. Every time I go to the beach, it get bad again, and then finally, the whole beach thing was blocked severely in dreams and in portents and in every which way. I was spooked away from it, badly spooked from it. Wow, so many bad signs arose. So it was saying, look, you've done enough, you've done enough, you've done enough, don't waste your life. Because I could easily turn into a vagabond, wasting my life, taping beautiful water, you know. That's not it. And Facebook, you can waste your life looking at beautiful images on Facebook, you know. And the Holy Spirit said, that's enough. It's enough. Time to meditate. So the goal is to meditate. I am an apex yogin. So we do apex yoga. The goal is to practice saying, I am an apex yogin. Apex yoga is to affirm, I am an apex yogin. Wow. That's what apex yoga is. It's a very simple yoga, isn't it? But it's the most profound. It's so simple you can't miss it. There's no excuses. Either you're an apex yogin or you're not. An apex yogin says, I am an apex yogin. Wow. And that's our practice. Okay, that's our practice. Kind of hard to get around this one, isn't it? So I'm waiting for the apex yogins, you know, to apex yogins arise. It has to be those who are actually saying this. I am an apex yogin. Wow. And they're committed to it, saying, you know, this is really what works. This is what actually works. And I'm willing to accept what works and work at that. Probably need to make these videos, you know, subscription only, unlisted. And then only those who are apex yogins get to see them. That's what I did with the intensive. I have a ton of videos that I released in the intensive. Gorgeous, unbelievably nice, beautiful videos. It was only for those in the intensive because they were committed to take the intensive. But now you have to be an apex yogin maybe to see the better ones, because you know you're committed to the practice no matter what the content arises in your life. You're still committed to the practice of saying, I am an apex yogin. So very sublime stuff can arise. And then this sort of helps you realize that it's not even this. Instead of waiting and hoping that maybe somebody, some creative genius will come along and produce some really beautiful stuff for me and that'll be it. Well, some creative genius has come along, but to say, this is not it. This is not it. It never will be it. It never will be it. Beautiful reflective services. I have all sorts of videos that are designed for me or help me realize it's not it. Doesn't matter how beautifully reflective the surface is. You are, formlessness cannot be reflected. Okay? I am an apex yogin. Wow. That's it. Just that. Just settle on one thing, that's it. And that's what apex yogin says. I am an apex yogin. Wow. And that's it. Nothing more. You're nothing more than that. So in religions, the beautiful art was only for those who were highly advanced in the spiritual practices so that they could help them, you know, realize that no matter how much beauty I find in the world, that's never going to be it either, okay? And so it helped them from wasting time waiting around for something, hoping they can find something. They visualize, some of the visualization religions and techniques, they try to visualize the most beautiful beauty they can, and then they practice dissolving it. Well, we do that automatically here with I am an apex yogin. Wow. That automatically beautiful imagery just arises. The mind just produces it. So you don't have to practice visualization, because just practice this I am an apex yogin. Wow. And you know, you will have, like for me, this pearl lake arises. Just like the most beautiful reflective lake imaginable, just automatically the mind just imagined it for me. So I could just notice and say, okay, I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. And don't ever say, I am not that lake. Always affirm the positive now in this practice. I am an apex yogin. Wow. Just stick with that. So beautiful, beautiful stuff. You don't need the tankas, and you don't need the visualization practices, etc. The stuff will automatically arise for you in your meditation. Don't try to make it arise. It'll try to beguile you away. So of course it's going to present all sorts of beguiling imagery to you. The mind is all creative, so of course it can do this. If you can visualize it, the mind can present it to you automatically. As it tries to beguile you, it will. So just say, I'm an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. Okay, and I'm getting cold out here. So, just wow. You know, and all I can do is just keep wowing it and see what the next step is. I don't know. That's okay. It's bound to happen. I just have to stay humble in the wow, right? So just take this to heart, and again, there's a pre-intensive for you. Just imagine that in 2018, you're going to feel desperate, and you don't want to pray fall to vices. The world may very well fall prey to a vast array of vices, which is the desperate people in the world right now are frantic to legalize all vices so they can just indulge in them to the utmost, you know. because they're feeling so desperate. They think, oh my gosh, I need these vices, I need these vices, I need these drugs, whatever, right? And so anyone tries to prohibit that, they become absolutely furious, like their identity is being attacked or something. You know, that's how bad it is right now. Any attempt to go back to something appropriate is seen, for them, as the devil. You know, and then they say that you're mentally ill to even suggest that. They try to slander you in every possible way. These, you know, lunatics, these vice lunatics are like that. And the more desperate they get, the more that they're that way. So don't count on culture going back in that direction at this point. Don't count on it. They'll fight to the death to prevent that. So you have to just make sure you meditate, okay? You make sure you do your meditation. And consider taking this pre-intensive, one-year pre-intensive, an apex yoga pre-intensive, apex yoga pre-intensive. And again, it's simple, just and just say, and practice it. You will discover, as you practice, you will come in touch with whatever you want to, you know, what arises for you. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I still have to be cautious. I can feel there's still, attitudes out there that can get me somehow. You know, they it's very tricky, very tricky. Those who are truly desperate and truly practicing, I can feel there's no problem. I don't feel any problem. I feel like, you know, they're going to do it, and they're going to keep working at it. There are others I can feel there's a problem will develop, because they're after some image that they, maybe me, you know, that they can substitute. Say, okay, this is what I am. This image or something like that. So I don't want any part of that. You want to look at it, look at a body, look at Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, okay? Aram Maharshi. Very great. That's it for this one.